Three, two, one.
Master Chief, defend this station.
Yes, sir. I need
Zeitgeist Zealots.
Right this way.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to Zeitgeist Zealots. I'm Forrest.
I'm Major.
And I'm Robbie.
And this is Democracy Officer Ramjack here, speaking to you from the Terminid Infested Galaxy.
And Matt, I guess?
Matt. Yes, Matt's here with us. Awesome. Always happy to have Matt. He brings a lot of bona fides to our podcast, you know, a lot of wise knowledge. But since we're talking about Helldivers first, I think I'm just going to sit back and zip my trap because I did not play with y'all this past weekend. But
no,
y'all played a lot.
No, you're still Team Xbox, which is respect. I'm Team Xbox, I also have a PC. I think you can play
a Helldivers on Xbox.
No.
PlayStation and PC.
It's only PC and PS5.
Okay. On PC.
Unfortunately, the Xbox does not offer the option to spread democracy throughout the galaxy at this time.
God
it
damn it,
Bill
Gates. It
may be coming, however, democracy is currently being gatekept by the corporates over there at Sony. We do love capitalism and democracy. However, sometimes it doesn't benefit all.
You know, can I just
say... Bill Gates hates democracy.
Bill Gates does hate democracy. But Dr. Democracy over here is absolutely right. Dude, I got to tell you, this game feels like it came at the perfect time. Where, not getting political, there is one half of the country saying the other half of the country is trying to end democracy. And then, dude, you install Helldivers 2, and you get so fucking pumped up on spreading democracy, dude. Like, I get it now. I'm like, oh, I see, like, why... the government was so gung-ho in the 70s and 80s and 90s and spreading democracy. Dude, it's so much fucking fun. I mean, we're killing bugs, not...
So for laymen like me, how is killing bugs help spreading democracy? For somebody that hasn't played the game and doesn't really understand the concept.
Because you're not the fighting... bugs are trying to infringe upon your human rights as a sovereign citizen of Super Earth. Super Earth does not tolerate... any kind of infringement upon our citizens' rights.
The
socialist automatons are another story, though. Super Earth will spread democracy throughout their planets, until there is not a drop of socialism left in the galaxy.
Amen.
Right. Now, when you're spreading democracy to automatons, though, make sure you are equipping extra heavy weaponry. You're going to want shotguns and explosives and lasers. Whereas with the Terminids, fire and inflammables are great ways to spread democracy.
Good tips there.
Pro tips on spreading democracy. Forget stuffing ballots. You better stuff those portals with grenades to close them up, right?
So, yeah. Out of character, though, Helldivers 2 is a really good, if you've ever seen Super Troopers, the movie or the series of movies, it's a tongue-in-cheek, like, making fun of the military-industrial complex within democracy and how it all functions and everything. And it's just a really good tongue-in-cheek. You know, the details of the game, you know, everything down to the little details is what's, like, impressed
the
us.
The reviews
like,
on the game, on the guns and stuff you're wanting to upgrade, those are hilarious.
Yeah, like, you'll just be, like, scrolling through the helmets in the store and it'll be like... I supported the troops by buying this not once, but twice. It even fits the children, even though it's a little heavy. Take it on your camping trip. Like, it's amazing how to...
Very World War II. Awesome. Aren't there war bonds as well?
Oh, yeah. You're buying war bonds to unlock things.
You put your medals from the missions you do, or medals you find, and you put them into upgrades. And that's their... instead of a battle pass, they have their premium war bond thing that you put medals into.
Talk about scalability too. Like, if you like a challenging game, this game will have you on the edge of your seat.
Haven't even done the last two difficulties yet. It gets hard.
There have been few games in my recent memory that have given me the adrenaline rush that this game does, and
the epic music really adds to
the French horns,
the cinematography,
the French horns.
But I will tell you, the most dangerous thing when you play this game will be your teammates. It will be their stratagems.
There is friendly fire in Helldivers.
Friendly fire? No.
Talk about tongue-in-cheek, one of the game tips was just, like, one of the in-game tips on the loading screen. Friendly fire, isn't.
Yeah, very. That's it. Yeah, very tongue in cheek. It's not fun at all.
Friendly fire. Is it
loading screen? What are you talking about? Loading screen? You're just dropping in.
Yeah.
It is really well hidden loading parts of the game.
And the attention to detail, because even the background, it's
not just a general drop animation. The background and everything is related to where your ship is.
Mm-hmm. On a scale of Halo 1 to Halo Infinite, how fun is this multiplayer?
Oh God, that's a terrible scale.
Yeah.
Halo 1's...
Well, Halo 2, I think, is better than Halo 1.
If we're rating it by Halo, is that...
Halo I mean, 2 I, is I the would highest. Be like...
It's below yeah, Halo 2 and Halo like 3, but above
Halo 2
Infinite.
And watching paint dry. It's way closer to Halo 2.
I missed the paint drying game when I was growing up, but
I forgot how strict your parents were. That's right.
There is literally a pressure washing simulator that got pretty popular there for a little
bit. That's what I was just thinking of. They got pressure wash simulator. God,
Biden's made everything so awful that like not only are people just playing this game, but I guarantee you on Twitch people are watching people pressure watch. Not
well,
like a
so,
real thing.
So one of the great things about this game that's dystopia. Very unique is the community aspect where you can literally watch a planet get more and more liberated and you can join ongoing missions.
You can sit
can
on your ship
SOS
and see
and
all
bring
that.
You in if they're like getting desperate. And you can watch people's ships dropping in lasers and railguns, nuclear bombs. Like
it's a great spot. Just look out the front window of your ship, just seeing everything happen from orbit.
All right. Well, let me ask you this.
All the other players in the background. It's so cool.
I think I have a better scale now. How, on a scale of Scientology to cocaine, how much would you recommend this to your friend?
Whoa, so wait, Scientology is...
is bad. Don't recommend Scientology to your friends.
What are the scales?
Why are you recommending cocaine to your friends?
How about on a scale from good to bad? How about we'll start there?
It's an awesome game. 10 out of 10.
Oh, yeah.
Favorite game that I've played this year. I've got several friends that will agree with you. It's the kind of game that you appreciate to the point that you go and give the developers money after you bought the game. Not because it gives you anything extra.
Yeah.
Just because you want to support the development and the future progress of the game. Because
yeah.
let me tell you, this game has community event potential written all over it. Like
yeah, it's so much fun.
And it wasn't just like
Halo.
And apparently, I saw on a Twitter post from one of the developers. And he even put at the end of one of them, and this came from a group of 100 or 200 people. Versus he's basically bragging in a way.
Isn't he like he's super base too, right? Like he's come out on Twitter and he said, "Hey guys, we have bad server times right now because we're so fucking popular. Like we were expecting 50,000 people and we're getting 500,000 people or something like that." And so he said, "Hey guys, if you're worried about if something about like slow service is going to piss you off, don't buy the game yet." Right, yep. And that's something very rare. You never hear someone say that.
Well, they're just being really like transparent about everything that's going on. They were saying how they're working on the queue issues. They raised the cap of. It was within 2 days they fixed the queue time.
I'll tell you this: I heard all these issues. I was hesitant to get it, but you guys were talking so much about it. I bought the game, downloaded it. I've had like. Zero issue. I mean, there's like some glitches and bugs like here and there or whatever, but like,
you came in after they fixed the queue.
For those who are still sitting on the sideline, don't worry about it, dude. It's so much fun. Go ahead and jump in and start spreading democracy.
They fixed all the issues.
If 2024 has taught us anything, though, 2024 has taught us anything, it is that concepts, well executed concepts that are fun and engaging, are outperforming. These blockbuster titles, Starfield, for
that
example,
are just kind of the same thing. Oh, Starfield was so disappointing.
Palworld and Helldivers 2 were both small teams that were, you know, they came out, they had a lot of issues, but their communication and their engagement with the community around the issues that you were having.
And they're just coming in and kicking ass compared to these other
Suicide
huge
Squad.
And it's the concept. It's just fun. Yeah.
Like the Suicide Squad game, like I think it's had a major drop off in players, and like nobody's playing it. So I mean, I don't even think that game's gonna like last the year. Like they're promising on this DLC that's probably never gonna like come to fruition, or all this planned DLC is probably not, you know, because no one's actually playing the game.
Are you talking about Suicide Squad?
Yeah, Suicide Squad. Like, yeah, no one's.
Yeah. Oh,
it's like dropped.
Another thing with
like 10,000 like users.
Other games, with their, they're doing their microtransactions with battle passes and stuff. Oh, yeah. A bunch of the stuff is completely locked behind a paywall. Where this, they do have super credits, which you buy with real money, but you can grind for super credits in the missions.
My
you
know, favorite.
So if you want to grind for it, you don't have to buy those super credits.
I love that option. I hate that when you have to literally just pull out the credit card to win.
And the base game is $40. I bought $40 worth of super credits just because I was like,
they're trying to push these $70 like, games that are really not worth $70.
Yeah. They're not even finished. It's like, here's
how much was Suicide Squad?
It was 70 or it was 60 or 70.
Suicide
maybe like 70
Squad was going for $70.
$70, and I'm sure they have some $110 version where you get like the ultimate summer pass.
And everyone hated the story.
They killed
it. I guarantee that.
It was a rip off Borderlands.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of Borderlands, we're talking about that trailer today. A group watch.
I'll stay for that.
You want to watch the Borderlands trailer?
Jack Black's role was a good pick.
Major Robbie and me, Major, you start. Last impressions of Helldivers 2.
Buy the fucking game. This is the most fun I've had since Halo was good. Get the game.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, no question. This game is in my top five. I'm still trying to figure out where in my top five, but it's up there.
I will say that this has probably been the biggest surprising game that I have played in the last like handful of years.
I didn't even hear about the first game.
Yeah, no, Helldivers 1 undersold, but Helldivers 2, I don't know. Maybe it's just the social media got behind it, but like for good reason. The game came out, it blew a lot of minds with just its fun and just tongue-in-cheek, irreverent. Like,
is this
enjoyable, adrenaline fueled, just great game?
I think this is a left wing psyop to try to stop Donald Trump from getting elected as president.
Trying for the hashtag.
Whoever stays in the edit.
Before we leave Helldivers 2, it's heavily influenced by Starship Troopers, correct? So,
and Terminator and the entire Terminator series, the automatons are literally like
Halo. ODST. Did you guys hear, Rob? I'm sure you saw this floating around Twitter, X, that the Bungie 343 actually pitched 8 to 12 ODST games like Helldivers 2, and they all got rejected.
Yeah, you mentioned that one of the last podcasts.
So like we could have had this.
Probably kicking themselves.
Uh-huh.
They had the concept, but ODST was pretty much the same thing.
Well, ODST was basically Helldivers. You're just like having like swarms and swarms of enemies come at you.
But this throws like some comedy into it.
That was ODST. That was ODST on Earth. They're talking about like sending ODST like planet wide, like Halo Wars. Like,
this is a galaxy wide map.
Exactly.
Not just stuck
in Chicago.
So it's like Starfield meets ODST.
Right. Exactly.
Okay. So Matt, what were your first memories of Starship Troopers?
Yeah, nothing like Starfield.
We can reel you into the conversation.
Actually, I saw it in theaters in high school.
Yeah, he's so old. He's so old, ladies and gentlemen. No, I'm kidding.
Honestly, it was kind of frustrating. It's a great movie, but Starship Troopers.
Early 90s.
90s.
Wait. How old do you think Matt is? Do you think Matt's in his 50s? That's not his
50s. Wow.
Just throw the age in there.
I was having fun. Robbie was being insulting.
Damn.
No, I'm kidding. Go on, Matt. What upset you about Star Troopers?
Neil Patrick Harris was in Starship Troopers, right?
Yep.
They should get him to do a commercial for Helldivers 2.
Since
they're like, you know, because he'll do anything pretty much.
The Candyman, you know, is that a Doctor Who burn?
Yeah. I haven't seen his Doctor Who special, but it looked just awful.
I've heard it's very gay.
And I couldn't.
I don't know what that means for NPH, but. That's a very bold statement to say about a Doctor Who.
He's playing a character who's the exact polar opposite of Barney Stinson, who he played on How I Met Your Mother.
Barney Stinson was the best.
He was great, yeah, but in the his character in Doctor Who is like the exact opposite, like not into women at all.
Oh, where'd he go?
Oh, we lost Matt.
He got mad at you. Y'all cut him off and called him old. Like, that's literally, he started talking.
I would leave too if that was the case.
So, Matt, what do you think about Neil Patrick Harris doing a commercial for Helldivers 2 since he was in Starship Troopers? Yay or nay?
I haven't seen it, but I think it would be funny if that were true.
You never seen Starship Troopers? I thought you said you just
Seen Starship Troopers. I've seen Starship Troopers. Like you're saying, if he were to do
he should do commercial. A Helldivers 2 commercial. Yeah.
I want to hear the story of Matt watching Starship Troopers in theater.
And great.
And he had a high when Denise Richards.
Really great anecdote. Seriously, yeah, man. Please, Matt, share.
Where I was kind of going with that was movie's awesome. But it kind of hits you way too over the head with certain themes that I find funny that people are missing out on now with this game coming out.
Oh, yeah.
However, I find it funny how the movie was this cool action movie, Nazis are bad type deal, versus the book is actually an interpretation about sending kids to war.
Mm-hmm.
And literally at the end of the movie, they're hiring like little kids, and that's the only kind of like, homage they do to the book.
So it was taken over by corporate Hollywood, basically.
Yeah, was that promo with the kid?
Yep. But the book is very anti-war, very sending kids, overseas. And the movie kind of spins it as, look how cool we are fighting bugs.
Yeah.
Who wrote it? Robert Heinlein wrote the book?
Yeah, Heinlein wrote it.
Yep. It's a satire.
Of science fiction.
Right. I think a lot of people just they completely miss the satire, which is hilarious because it's not subtle.
It's not. It's in your face.
They watch it. Yeah. Yeah. And the movie is very, very not subtle.
Neil,
I don't know. There's
Patrick
a lot of.
Harris is dressed as a Nazi.
There's a lot of propaganda. God, he's such a good looking Nazi, too. No,
how old are the characters in the book, Matt? Are they like teenagers or.
And they just graduated high school in the book.
Yeah.
Okay, so
he's legal. I go back to saying he's good looking.
Oh, so like actual like regular. I mean, not regular age, but I mean they are.
They're ready for war. Tour. Yeah,
I was thinking like I was thinking.
Yeah, they can die. 18, 17, perfect age to die. Yeah,
you can go.
Yeah.
Kill in a different country. So I mean, it's interesting because I was thinking like it was like Lord of the Flies, but like meets Star Wars, something like that. That'd be interesting though. So, let's watch the Borderlands trailer, shall we?
Let's. And then I'm going to the dog bar.
Arf, arf, arf.
Trying to pick up some bitches.
This is Reach.
Oh, come on! That was a great joke!
Oh,
God. Fuck all of you guys!
How's it taste, Majors?
No, dude, I'm about to leave this podcast myself, dude. I'm mad. That was not it. That was 10 out of 10. It was well structured.
Destiny awaits.
There. I don't know. If this is in the video, comment down below. Was that a good joke? He's going to the dog bar.
Throw Major a bone, y'all.
Yeah, throw me a.
Oh, it's a Halo ad.
Throw me a bone.
Y'all aren't getting a Halo ad?
Yeah, I got a Halo ad.
Is it on a ring or is it on an actual planet? I see a ring. I don't see anything. Okay.
Oh, it's like a minute in now.
Yeah. In the beginning. Kate Blanchett got peed on.
Oh, I think. I can't control it. Only Major.
Major's
can.
Hosting. Yeah. Is Major out?
Ow, I joined your activity. Anyway, we'll go back.
I joined your activity because it said you were
Major,
hosting.
Sorry,
so
I'm gonna start it.
Anyway, we're watching it.
Oh, I think Forrest is
there. We go,
it, baby.
We're a professional podcast.
Because it wouldn't. Well,
destiny awaits. Is that Kevin Hart? Fuck yeah!
Legend has it. Yeah, but he's playing character. He's like 6'3" in the game.
I mean, Kevin Hart plays the same character in every fucking role he plays.
Man, Kate Blanchett's a little bit.
So,
why is Kate Blanchett Judy Foster? Like, both of whom were like 40 plus in this
20 years ago.
I think Kate Blanchett might be in her 50s.
Maybe.
The only Borderlands experience I have is that Tiny Tina's game, Yeah, and they didn't realize she was like a main character in Borderlands. Yeah.
Oh, actually, I saw a headline, Spencer, the other day that there are like no young superstar actresses anymore. Like all the roles go to like older women.
What do you mean, Zendaya?
And then Zendaya, who's like a Disney character.
Isn't it Taylor Joy?
Margot Robbie.
That's a good point. All right, I'll tweet that. I'll tweet that author and let them know how fucking stupid they are. What? I didn't say that. That was just the headline.
Why are Judy Foster's tits out? You see that?
No, what? We're gonna, but we will though.
Jodie Foster's in this movie. Looking for this vault?
Yeah, but like there was a scene right there where she had like
makeup. Oh wow!
Right there.
Just
Jamie
Lee
Curtis.
Jamie, that's Jamie Lee Curtis. That's who I meant.
Yeah, Jamie Lee D cups. Holy shit!
But you know, still.
What did I tell you? Explosions.
No explosions. No explosions. Yeah, I love how Cambridge has like 56 and has a haircut of a 26-year-old. Oh, Jack Black is Claptrap? There you go. Wow, so it turns out Ariana Grande is like an awful person in real life. That's a bummer. She's so talented. I need a gun. So you ask for it.
There's only one of you in the world. You're special. Explosions.
I don't know. Does this look wacky enough to be a Borderlands game? Movie adaptation?
Ma'am. I'm here for it. I'm going to give it a 3 episodes. Let me put it this way. It can't be worse than Twisted Metal.
Yeah.
I haven't even watched that.
If I go in with Twisted Metal expectations, and this will be amazing. I'm expelling the excess lead. I
can't go if you're looking at me. It's a poop joke. That's amazing.
Yeah,
if you're looking at
people online are really upset they didn't use a Cage the Elephant song in this trailer.
I don't see a red button.
We're just gonna see how long it takes everyone else to
down
the
forest and Matt again.
I don't see a red
button.
Let's see
if you can get this first.
tap the video, see if you see a red button pop up or disconnect.
Every fucking week. Oh, Matt, I believe in you.
It must look different on the phone. I don't know.
I believe in you, Matt. You can get there before Forrest. Forrest has done this every week for the last 3 weeks. Oh, no!
Forrest found it.
You got to. Well, first of all, you got to press
the video.
Yeah, I mean, the
other walk screen. Matt, walk Matt button. How to do it. Walk Matt how to do it.
Hey, press it was my first space. Try. First
press
try.
Major space.
You're the best, for sure.
Yep.
My phone,
right
so
out. First try.
I'm not on my PC, so.
Can I just kick Matt?
It was my PC.
Okay, Boomer. By the way, Forrest is secretly 65.
This is like the video game episode. We're talking about Helldivers 2, Borderlands, Halo.
We're talking about Halo next.
Yeah, this is a video game episode. Yeah.
We're finally talking about video games. Like after like 3 years during the podcast, we're finally reviewing video games. And well, we talk about Halo.
Dr. Democracy, we really appreciate you coming on. We're about to talk about Halo, so I don't want to spoil that for you. I know you just started it. I'll give you the Helldivers salute.
He needs to get back out there.
Robbie can't do
his part.
Because Robbie gave up his salute. Robbie can now do rock, paper, scissors instead. Robbie
You were even watching that I had that at the window.
Oh, you did have that at the window. That's right. No, I forgot.
Yeah,
All right.
Changed it.
My bad.
Just remember, if you want to be a super citizen, you have to spread democracy the way I like cheeks. Fix me.
Super Earth out. Thanks, Super Earth. All
he
right,
needs to
guys.
Get back out there and do his part.
What a fantastic thing. We appreciate Dr. Democracy for stopping by and spreading some democracy and spreading some cheeks at the same time. We appreciate that. But now we got to get to the regular, your regularly stationed programming, and that's me talking about how I told you so. That's right, bitches. You're about to feel like what it feels like to be married to Major, because I'm about to say I told you so for 30 straight fucking minutes. What's up, guys? Last week, I ranted about how I said Halo was prestige television, and I got so much hate and flack online. Motherfuckers, I just want to tell you.
Just as much this
for it being good?
Yeah, for 100%. Being good. I said Halo was prestige TV. I said, watch out, guys. I said, if this was on HBO, we'd all be talking about this show differently, but it's on that shit app Paramount Plus. Sorry, so it's like a cheap hooker. It's a gourmet hooker and a cheap
bar. It could have been looked at differently.
Wait, let me tell you.
IMDb gave it a 9.2, episode 4, right? Season 2 on Rotten Tomato right now has a 94%. What I'm saying is, and these are, you know, fuck the numbers. Fuck the audience score. Audience score is 71, higher than last season, right? But you have to remember that we're bitter. The audience is just bitter in general.
Yeah, man. What I'm saying is try it out. Been a lot better.
I didn't really quite like this episode, just for like the main reason. I don't really like when he goes antique shopping. Maybe that's what you're really hoping for to see, like him go antiquing.
I have notes on that. We're gonna get to the episode, but first we have to get through some news first.
We'll do some news, but I'm not gonna cut you on board with you as the.
That's fine. Hate away. Hate away. Hater.
Like a little cutaway for news section.
Yeah. Nerd news. Guys, did you hear that Disney?
2 hours later.
Sure, that'll work. Why was it salt? Who cares? Disney will soon be outsourcing the distribution of its home entertainment media marketing to Sony. That means that Sony will manufacture, distribute, and market all DVDs, Blu-rays, and other physical media of Disney. So,
yeah.
Interesting partnership there.
Interesting timing when no one uses physical DVDs or Blu-rays anymore.
I mean, Best Buy has decided to stop selling like physical media, like in a mind-blowing.
Yeah, I mean,
which this is so scary for me. I'm not some kind of doomsday prepper. I'm not a prepper. But if you want to sprinkle in a dose of doomsday, guys, like EMPs are a real thing, and if you want to have real chaos in this fucking country. Take away our source of entertainment. Dude, everyone's entertainment is on the internet now. If the power goes out, if the internet goes out, people own 3 books and 2 movies, okay? You know how long it is before we fucking kill each other just for some god dang entertainment? Just some gladiator style?
I wonder.
Like, no office?
My power went out. At least I had my thick, invincible compendium.
Oh, and don't forget.
Exactly,
that
right? Like physical mediums. AT&T went down.
Major outage this week. I couldn't use my phone for like from like the morning to like till around like afternoon. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, but like I couldn't like use text. I couldn't surf the internet. I couldn't check my email. Luckily,
this could happen. This could happen so quickly in this 21st century, especially with how much infrastructure and like how good hacking China or how good
the
China
power of an EMP bomb or something.
It sounds like a James Bond plot, like basically a Japanese.
It is. It's every like James Bond plot.
He causes an EMP, so everyone has to buy the physical media from his company.
Like, this if so I was China,
he's gonna cause an EMP. Yeah.
If I was China or Russia and I wanted to take America out without losing a soldier, I would one institute whatever bullshit we've been doing to social media the last 20 years. So that America is at the powder keg it is right now, and then I would take away our source of entertainment. It's just that easy, right? Like as soon as like the movies, the internet goes out, dude. Like no one owns books anymore. Fucking half of our kids don't even know how to read. Okay, I think there's a real issue there. So hold on to your DVDs, guys. Go out maybe.
This issue in a serious point as to why you should buy DVDs still and buy books. You never actually own what you download.
That's a good
this
point.
Has been proven
That's
very
the thing with Steam.
Several times with Steam, with Google,
all those games,
people
that you
who
got,
bust
that you
up
don't even
and they
own.
Can no longer distribute it. But not only that,
say it
with streaming companies right now, look at how often, what's that show? The Office has jumped from one streaming service to the next, to the next. There are movies out there that I own that aren't part of any streaming service. It's just not streamable.
You'll never, and they'll never be on TV again. They'll never be on TBS at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Exactly. So 100% about, you know, you need to have physical media because you own that versus trying to chase it down. I was trying to watch Contagion. When COVID first happened, I wanted to show my wife Contagion.
Right.
And no streaming service had it. I could pay $15 for Google to rent it for 3 days. But I'm not paying that when I could actually go out and buy it. And I did.
Right.
Yeah. That would be just probably more than just finding the DVD or
starring
something.
Matt Damon. Yeah.
And I highly suggest you go to your local third party, store like the Book Rack or whatever. where that sells books and DVDs.
Your local bookstore.
For like $2 a pop.
Local comic book.
Oh, yeah, because mostly so. All my books that I've been reading, and I put reading in quotations, I have an Audible. So, like, I have no, like, physical books. I haven't, like, bought a physical book in years. I've just listened to them on Audible, but that's a good point. I should probably, if Audible ever goes down or, you know, I won't be able to access those books even when I can't even, you know, watch TV shows or movies.
Ooh,
so.
Look at that gorgeous library.
Look at that collection right there.
Well, you got the entire Wheel of Time series right there, so that should last you a few years at least if power, if like the power goes out. So, I mean,
wait, we have the entire Wheel of Time series?
I've actually, all right, not to date myself once again, but I actually was reading that series. I was reading that series in high school when like book 7 and 8 were coming out. And I've actually read through this series about 3 times now, and my wife wants me to throw it away every few years, asks me why. You've already read it 3 times. Like, well, I might want to read it again.
Yeah. No. Just like call me, hey, put me on the phone. I'll yell at your wife. I'm like, there's no way I'm letting you let him throw that out.
At least my parents got a whole wall of totally legit DVDs.
But no, there's several stores out there where you can get
as long as they're physical. Yeah.
So
they're all physical DVDs.
Guys, and like,
some of them might have came out of a printer.
Not physical. Not the covers.
Physical. Get DVDs, book copies, and then just to be conspiratorial again, not to be conspiratorial again, I just want to remind everyone, the WEF, that's the World Economic Foundation, the WEF said that you will own nothing and be happy about it, all right? Like, they don't want you to own cars in the future. They want everything to be rideshare. They don't want you to own any property. So
sounds a little
fight back, buy some goddamn comics from your local comic book store. And then, you know, I'd probably say go out and get Halo 2 box set. Go out and get the Halo box set series. But yeah, I can't.
Get the
can't.
Halo books. Way better than the show.
Buy the Halo books. The Halo books are so good.
They were really good.
Yeah.
I kind of, man, after it's kind of gotten me into it. Wanting to read them again. It's been.
Dude, I almost.
I have a quick question for you.
It's been
years. I have
years.
A quick question for you.
I almost read Fall of Reach.
You read the Fall of Reach, right?
Yep. Robin, I did in high school.
Was Master Chief in his armor, yes or no?
It was a long time ago. I mean, some parts.
I mean, there's.
And did he go antiquing?
He didn't go antiquing, but we'll get there. Okay. Anyway, before we get there, though, I want to point out a couple of things. Damn, dude, you really did not like that scene, did you? Did you just want to talk about that?
No, I did not.
I was upset.
That scene ruined it all for me.
I was upset.
No,
he
not
didn't.
Not just that scene, just the existence of the episode.
Okay, well, I'm going to actually shit on your entire existence when we get to that scene, because I'm going to tell you how that scene is integral to the writing, because it shows the reluctance of people leaving their home. Right? Yes, they're getting attacked by the Covenant, but the humans have a home. And this is what gives the Master Chief the inspiration to fight that old red, the old bitch in the red from the first episode, this bitch at the pawn shop in this episode. Like, I'm telling you.
And it's kind of cool how just like basic items from our time
were antiques, and they're so cool. Now, I will say the one big flaw from this scene.
They used to actually chop wood and use it for fuel.
Ooh,
like it's some caveman thing.
Like it's worth a Bitcoin or something.
That axe is probably worth more than Master Chief makes in a year. But I don't know what his salary is, but
he's
like E7.
The big fuck up from the writers in this scene was not giving letting Master Chief grab that antique shotgun. Dude, a Master Chief with a pump action going through lailing down Covenant with like some 500-year-old shotguns, dude, that would have been sick. So I agree, they fucked up with that part.
Some Doom level stuff,
right? But there's something called riding.
So wait,
dude, how about when he jumped on that? Well, before all that happened, when the elites first showed up,
hold on, we can't talk
that was
about
it. Because we're already jumped in the middle of the episode.
No, we're not talking about Halo yet, because I have to talk to you about Madam Web. Did you know Madam Web still hasn't made as much money as Morbius in its opening weekend?
Not surprised.
Well, did you know
Morbius
that?
How much money of it was just from it becoming a meme?
Well, no. So
how much of that money, I wonder.
The second
and people going to see it just to kind of
the
get
second
it.
Re-release was less than $500,000, Robbie. It was less than $500,000 the second re-release.
Oh yeah, I thought that was hilarious how they took all that seriously.
They were like, memes, this must be good. And then the average theater. Go ahead.
We were busy that week and released Morbius a third time. That was a campaign online.
Oh yeah, I remember that. Yeah, they're like, no, we were busy. Please try it. Release it again. But the average movie theater raked in $74 in total box office sales for Morbius re-release. So the internet won that one.
If you get the chance, there's a YouTube channel called Pitch Meeting, which I really love.
Oh, it's the best.
And he nails this one. And it's worth the watch.
Shout out to Ryan George.
I just feel bad he actually has to watch.
I think I might have seen clips from that. I'll have to look them up.
But yeah, it's interesting because like at least Morbius had like a comic series it could draw from. Like Madame Web has no solo series. She's like an ancillary character in Spider-Man, and Sony just does not even understand the IP they control when they're like giving characters like this their own movie.
But they look like Spider-Man, and Spider-Man's all we got. And he looks like Spider-Man. Yeah. That's the thinking behind Venom, and you know.
This could be a very successful
comic series, and Venom is like one of, along with Joker, the most popular villain in comics.
I guess my point kind of though is they own the IP to like the Spider whatever.
Spider-Verse.
And if they have this mindset that if they make it look like Spider-Man, then they can sell a movie, and it's flopped over and over and over again. As if we're this obsessed with Spider-Man that we want to see. And so, dude, I'm worried about Kraven.
No, you're being when Kraven comes out, it's gonna be amazing. No,
15 million box office opening weekend. I've already called it like 2 months ago. So, flip it again.
And it goes back to my whole, can't we just introduce a Sinister Six together? Why do we have to have individual movies?
The geniuses behind Helldivers 2, the company behind Helldivers 2 cannot make a bad Spider-Man movie after Bad of Web, I'm sure. I did remajor that Venom 3 has wrapped filming.
Oh, well, that's good.
It's about to. And it's amazing because, like, no plot leaks have come out.
I didn't even know they were filming Venom 3. Like, that's amazing and that they're like, the balls crazy. On this company.
I wonder if it's like Marvel where there is no plot yet and they're going to refilm.
They film it in post.
Then write it. Yeah. So they just know that in the whole Marvel thing, we have the big fight in the third act, and then we just, in post, we figure out the rest of the story.
Well, this is interesting. Like, we know so much about Deadpool 3. We pretty much like know the entire plot from Deadpool 3, and we know nothing about Venom 3. But I don't know. It's gonna be like, it's interesting because like Let There Be Carnage made like $350 million less than the first Venom movie. So I think audiences are wising up.
They're wising up to it. You know, we do know.
But that movie had freaking Carnage in it. Like another one of the most popular villains.
But it was hinted by Woody Harrelson in the worst wig of all time. There was no hype to see Carnage. You know what I'm saying?
Well, it still made like $500 million. I mean, it was still profitable.
It was still profitable. It didn't make as much.
First one.
Yeah. Now, speaking of being profitable but probably not making as much, The Boys season 4 is coming out. We have a release date finally, June 13th. Mark it on your calendar. Go ahead, subscribe to the podcast if you haven't already. We will be covering this.
A longer wait than I wished it was, but
is it coming out on Friday 13th?
Sure, I'm gonna say yes, and then I'll fix it in post if not, or I won't.
Just like double over yourself. No, Forrest, you idiot.
No, it's not. just zooms in on a calendar. It's like every 13th doesn't have to be a Friday, Forrest.
It should though. Jason would be happy.
Let me ask you guys this. I just want to wrap up the news with one final thing. And that's a reminder. I think a nice little refresher before we get into Halo. And that's your boy Paul Schreiber, a.k.a. the Master Cheeks.
So June 13th is a Thursday.
What did I say, Paul? I'm in Pablo. June 13th is a Thursday?
I just looked it up.
Thank you. I appreciate that. There you go. So close, Forrest, but sorry. I guess the Knights
Jason's
Templar can live.
Unhappy.
Jason's unhappy because the Knight Templar live. But I might be happy because if you guys remember, a couple years ago, a report came out that your boy Pablo Shriver, you know, from the Master Chiefs from Halo, is on the shortlist to play Wolverine. Now, I know he's too tall for you, Forrest, But Matt, how do you feel?
He's taller than Hugh Jackman.
He is. He's so fucking tall. Are you familiar with the Shrivers, Matt? Do you know who Pablo is?
Yes. Yes.
Do you want to see Pablo as Wolverine?
Be a big Wolverine.
I'm intrigued, to say the least. It's kind of the short.
Can we say this? Can I stop real fast for a second? Guys, get this short king Wolverine shit out of your head, okay? I'm sorry, it's not gonna happen. I know
the tall Wolverine.
I know you guys are used to comic book Wolverine. He's 5'2", right? But short kings don't sell box office tickets, all right? Wolverine will be over 6 feet tall for the rest of our lives. I'm sorry. Get over it. Continue.
I guess the only thing that's going for him isn't he Canadian? So, you know, at least we're owning up to, you know, Wolverine's Canadian.
Wolverine's Canadian.
Tom Cruise's success is all due to his height, of course.
He stands on boxes. All of his success is due to his artificial height and Scientology. I don't know. Yeah, am I going to get sued for that? I apologize.
Pablo Schreiber's brother played Sabretooth.
Yeah.
It would be ironic, but, you know, it's sort of like in the family. But you know who would make a great Wolverine back in the day? Scott Kahn. He's like 5'5".
I'm not familiar with
that.
Who's that?
He was in Ocean's 11, Ocean's 12, Ocean's 13.
The remakes?
No, I guess they're because like Ocean's 11 was a remake of a movie with Frank Sinatra.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, he would have been great. I think.
So he was the guy in Varsity Blues, the receiver tweeter.
Yep.
Yep. Oh, okay.
Yeah. He's in Hawaii 5-0 now, I think, or he was. He's James Caan's son.
And that's Caan, C-A-A-N, not Caan like Star Trek.
C-A-A-N, yes.
Yeah.
So Scott Caan's my choice for Wolverine. If we went back in time, they were casting the movie.
Hawaii 5-0, let's do it.
I could see that. I could see that. That's respectable.
Yeah. Yeah, let's just get an actual, like, height accurate Wolverine.
Why?
That'd be awesome.
At this point.
Why not?
At this
why
point,
not?
Hollywood's going to make Wolverine black. So, like, just be happy with what you've got, okay?
What's that South Park meme?
Put a chicken in and make her gay? Make it lame, make her gay? That South Park meme?
Besides me, the other people who won't like this episode are probably the NAACP. We had not one but two major black characters get killed off in the last 5 minutes.
No, the diversity. Yeah, no, dude. Like, they killed their blind, gay, black character off. I was like, there's 80% of their DEI requirements right there. God, in a single scene.
And why'd they give the blind guy a grenade launcher?
So he could die against the race, but you're absolutely right. I actually have in my notes, why give the blind guy? However, I think that's actually better because if he had a regular gun, he could just stray bullets everywhere. With a grenade launcher, he's shooting once. Now, why he had the best kills of the whole game?
Good thing there's no friendly fire in Halo.
Exactly right.
Yeah.
But let's dive into it. We've teased this enough. Let's reach into the bottoms of our hearts and talk about this episode. IMDb gives it a 9.2 out of 10, and I give it a 6.9 out of 5. What an excellent episode, The Fall of Reach. I know Forrest didn't like it, which is why
The Fall of Reach without Master Chief in his armor, and let's kill off Captain Keyes too soon.
Let's talk about the armor.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the armor. Like, so if he had the armor, it would be too easy, and then he wouldn't be able to emote. Like, you take away your superhero's weapons. I mean, look at Iron Man 2. I know, the worst Iron Man, right? But you took away his armor, and you get to see him be a badass as a character. I mean, John literally tackles.
Iron Man 3, actually.
Is that Iron Man 3? I can't remember which one. Iron Man 3. So, like, John literally tackles an invisible elite and just, like, punches him breaks his fingers like a WWE move, and like it's too easy.
Like, they got those four split to their mouth. He grabbed one of them.
It's cool, man. It's cool.
Well, the thing is that the Covenants are supposed to be so powerful that a regular human should not be able to kill them. That's why they need the armor.
Like, the armor, a regular human.
He's not a regular human.
He's a Spartan. I have here in my notes.
Even with the armor, though, like the elites, especially the hunters.
Well, they do a lot more than just put armor on him and train him.
I have here in my notes.
Augmentation.
John takes on an elite without armor. I'm hard the entire time. I think that's how I best describe this entire episode, dude. Full on erection for
good thing it wasn't 4 hours. Me.
Yes.
Call a doctor.
Yeah. Good. Good thing it was only episode 4. What did you guys think about the invisibility? It was pretty game accurate. This show does not do a lot of game accurate things, but that invisibility.
Where before they were just, I guess they could play it off that it was the fog, but before you didn't see anything really.
Anything, and now you get the ripples.
The action was better. I mean, the CGI wasn't great, but it's like, you know, it's Paramount, so they're gonna skip while they can. I'm pretty sure like over like half of the season's budget went into this episode. It seemed.
I imagine so. Well, you haven't seen what happens next.
We said, I guess, the other half went to the first episode. What about the rest of the episode?
Yeah, like, that's what I was saying. Like,
that shopping area, like, where he fought the invisible elites, that looked like turf. Remember that map, turf?
Oh, from Halo 2? What a throwback.
I doubt the showrunners realized that. But, yeah, that would have been pretty awesome if they, like, he's literally fighting an elite in turf.
If he ends up on Zanzibar, I will lose my mind. That'd be super cool.
Yeah, they really need to like to earn like fan goodwill. I mean, they don't give a shit about fan goodwill, let's be honest.
No.
But they really should like set some episodes on some of these fan, like Blood Gulch. Imagine an episode they're in Blood Gulch fighting off.
Well, they have to get to the goddamn Halo even just, first. They have to get to the Halo
little,
before you get to the
little
maps.
Background Easter eggs that you could kind of recognize where they're at.
I will tell you this though. If this show was like, all right, we're about to cancel you unless you can pull out a banger. And then, like, Master Chief, just like, you have like a, I just had a brain fart. A bottle episode. You have a bottle episode, and when Master Chief is stuck on like Battle Creek or Coag, like, that would be so much fun, dude.
That would be awesome.
Just an episode for the boys. Exactly. Just an episode for the boys. He meets all the red versus blue. Just fucking have some fun with it. I guarantee you'll get some good piece of wool.
Oh, just for that filler.
Where was Kai this episode?
Gone, thankfully. Probably hooking up with Akerson. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, her and Akerson were gone.
Oh, yeah, no Akerson either.
Yeah, no Akerson. Well, we saw him at the beginning, I think, and then he dipped out.
We'll see Master Chief in his armor next episode before the fall of Reach.
Yeah, they took their armor.
Yeah. I mean, maybe Kai is on the ship and she's going to bring the armor back. Maybe. That's my prediction.
That would be dope. What do you
I wonder what their plan is with that armor.
It seems...
Put on other
Spartans. Akerson seems to be very, fuck the Reach. We're going to rebuild somewhere else and try over.
Yeah, they're basically, like he said, like you're just a guy in a suit. So yeah, like
you're replaceable.
You know, we can put someone else in the suit. Yeah, so he's basically gonna find someone else to put in the Master. It'd be interesting if he put like an asshole in the suit and then like Master Chief has to beat the asshole and get his suit back. How about that?
I'd be like, what is this, the Mandalorian?
Well, that basically I want my armor back. Daredevil Born Again, because like basically like Tinker Hire is like a serial killer. Yeah, he hires a serial killer to like wear Daredevil's suit to frame him to frame him, and Daredevil has to like beat him up and get his suit back. So.
It was
in
cool
the comic, not in the show, but
it was cool to see a Wraith on Reach.
Yeah,
for like 2 seconds. Yeah,
right until that blind guy sacrificed himself.
A Scorpion as well.
We saw a Scorpion for another 2 seconds.
Yeah, like, they're
cool. Fanboys. Are you happy?
Yes, I am. I've got it in my notes, dude. I was listening, and then dude, you hear like the the treads.
Oh,
like,
the wheels,
like, dude. The wheels are squeaking, And like you're like, oh boy, you know, dude, your heart starts fluttering. You know, the hair starts rising on your arms. You know exactly what that fucking sound is. It's a goddamn scorpion here to save the day.
Heard it so long,
For years. So like the comic accurate sound, at least it felt like it. So I really, really appreciated that. Comic accurate. I mean, game accurate, obviously.
If they changed up all the vehicles too, then
how cool would it have been though if like. A Helldiver just dropped down and blew up that Wraith.
Suddenly they throw in the same like epic music.
Oh my god, that'd be so cool. But that's how hooked on Helldivers I am. I'm watching Halo and I'm like, oh, they really could use like a reinforcement drop right here on this Wraith. Just take it out.
Yeah, so what did y'all think of Perez this episode? She had a pretty big part.
I liked her. I thought she was good. There's at the end where she's like, Master Chief is leaving, and she like Master Chief just leaves Perez without saying anything. And I was like, damn, dude, Master Chief is cold. What a badass. But then he turns around and talks to her, and I was like, oh, okay.
Here's a coin.
Okay. And then he flips the coin and he tells her it's head. And I was like, I mean, you're more badass if you didn't say anything at all. But you're okay now. I would have liked like a Luke and Leia moment. Not Luke and Leia, sorry, Han
they,
and Leia.
They find out their brother's missing a kiss.
Yeah, exactly. No, Han and Leia moment where she's like, oh, Master Chief, thank you, I love you. And he's like, I know. And then just walks away.
I do not. What is love?
I took my pill out. For, yeah. Matt, so far are you just can't wait to get off this fucking podcast and start binging this series yet?
Yeah, you know it.
How awesome it is.
Well, so I guess if season two gets better, it's season one. I watched the first two episodes and
season two gets better.
Season one?
Season two,
you can get through two, yeah.
Season two is great.
I mean, I want, so I, they basically doubled down the mistakes they made from season one, but.
But there's nice little homages.
At least Quan wasn't in this episode.
Thank God. Although I wouldn't have mind seeing Quan get killed. That's on my to-do list in 2024.
We lost Vanek and Keyes, two likable characters. Oh, they're dead.
Keyes, dude. I thought Keyes was going to live. I was like, yeah, no, make it a Halo 1.
What the hell are they going
to do? I thought he was going to have an Halo epic 1. Way out.
No, nah, dude. Nothing, dude. Because Master Chief was like, you have to, we need you to fight another day. And he was reluctant. He's like, all right, fine. I'll get off Reach. And then he does not. Spoiler. I was like, yeah, let's make it a Halo 1. Spoiler
alert. YouTuber Halo 1.
He does not make it a Halo 1. I was like, okay, game or movie, TV show. I guess we're just not going to do the game at all. Just
his twin brother. His twin brother, Jimmy Keyes.
I guess he's
going to command the killer bottom.
No, what's going to happen is Miranda. Yeah, no, his fucking Miranda, his woke-ass daughter, is going to fucking take over as the Keyes position or whatever for next
season. She didn't even show up till Halo 2, right? She was like the one who, like, Tartarus was like, put the key in the slit or something like that, you know, because only she could do it, right?
Something like that. Yeah, and which, by the way, I was watching some cutscenes the other day just to refresh myself. I forgot. She was a white girl. They have race swapped her. I don't care, but like, well, just for the people keeping track at home, there's another one on the list.
She was half black in the show last season, but well, she'll probably show up.
She's very white in the video game, I'll tell you that. Haircut included. She's got the full Karen hair.
We got to talk about Soren and Halsey this episode, and I was wrong. They did not have a long chat. They have like a very short chat. Yeah. Like, all right, I'm gone. Bye.
I thought they were going
to
like.
I've been trying to find you for 20 years, and now that I have you to myself, I'm just going to leave you. Bye.
Yeah.
So, very convincing. Way to go, writers.
A little underwhelming, I would say, for sure. But we were right. They did have to escape together.
Yeah. And they find Cortana, and then McKee gets there. Like, conveniently, McKee gets there at the same time.
Yeah.
To get Cortana, because writers.
Cortana says to run. And then they get hit with a grenade. I do like the part where...
Oh, when he slices through that wind, through the glass there with the sword.
That was cool, right?
So, was that Arlete? Is that supposed to be the Arbiter?
I believe so.
I listed in the credits.
Sure.
But the armor looks completely different, though, than what the games have. Because the game armor is like, it's like silver plated.
Right,
it's like more ancient looking. But that he looked like just another
unique.
Elite.
But, you know, I think like he is like the Arbiter at the moment.
Okay.
They wouldn't know. They didn't play the writers didn't play the video games.
Nope. So I was really looking forward to the sword battle between the Elite and Master Chief.
Oh my god, dude!
So I thought something epic was about to happen.
Instantly, dude! Instantly, he gets shot with a plasma pistol.
The Elite there felt our anger there,
and he just cut his head off. Yeah,
I was like, oh. I was like, oh, I'm actually gaining interest in this episode. And then the showrunner's like, cut that out right now.
Yeah, none of that.
That was the director's there. Just,
this is interesting. We got in that. We got to stop that.
I was thinking about it. And I was like, dude, what the fuck? Because I was full erection. So hard. Like, he picked
that
up that.
Awesome,
he picked up that energy sword, dude. I was like, let's go. I'm like rising out of my chair, ready for this epic sword fight that does not happen. But then I was thinking
about
it.
Pulls it out, has the
draw. I wonder if they tried to film an energy sword fight, and it just looks stupid. Because the energy swords are triangles, right? So, like, what are the logistics? How would that even really work in real life?
What direction it's going to go?
Just all of it. Like, how stupid, like, no other sword is shaped as triangular as an energy sword. I mean, regular swords, lightsabers, no matter what, there's like some regular combat involved. But like, I don't know. I think if you close your eyes and you picture an actual sword fight with these big fucking triangle broadswords. I think it might look kind of stupid to see Master Chief have a sword fight with an Arbiter in real life, like an actual sword fight. So yeah, maybe that's why they cut it. I don't know.
Another
can't do a Jedi like, battle with
yeah, Halo you can't. Swords. No, they're that thick. Like they're all like no. I think it would look.
Well, you can't two hand that thing.
Oh, you really can't. No, can you?
Dual wield. Yeah, you can't.
I guess you. I guess sword. You could.
Can you dual wield with a sword and a gun? I
think you could do that. Yeah, if you were cool. Just sword.
They don't even do dual wield. They don't do dual wield anymore on Halo Infinite.
That was just Halo 2, wasn't it?
Halo 3.
Was it 2 or Halo 3? 2,
like, I think it was 3.
I think, yeah. It's
absurd, yeah, 3 yeah. And shield bubbles.
3 or 4, 3 just get rid of all the cool stuff. So, so Vanek died.
Something cool's about to happen.
Nope, I don't think so.
I forget how much bigger the needlers are when they're in human hands.
Oh, they're they look massive. So small.
Oh, yeah.
They're like huge. But
R.I.P.
But how did he get the combine off with the one needle he stuck in his chest?
Yeah.
That exploded.
He shot Vanek and Vanek, or no, he grabbed a needle
and then his pigeons come at the very end and shit on him. Remember, they're looking at his pigeons, and just goes.
Oh, poor Vanek. We hardly knew you. It looked great visually. I thought
they finally gave
stunning.
You some character development. They gave you some character development this episode.
Yeah.
After giving you none in the first season, and then they just kill you all.
Here are my notes. I wrote R.I.P. Vanek, whose only character development was that he liked to watch documentaries.
He liked to watch Animal Planet.
Which, I mean, it is pretty relatable. We do like some docs over here. We love some limited series.
He was looking forward to Planet Earth 3, but he'll never get to see it now. Although it's the future. He's probably seen like Planet Earth 17. That was the episode. We saw McKee at the end.
Yeah.
And she's like full dark side now. Yeah. So dark side.
Chief was about to get sliced.
Do you think she still has feelings for the Chief?
Definitely.
That's why she didn't want him.
You don't see I think those Master Chiefs. Turn...
Why she stopped it right there.
Feelings, she's seen those cheeks. She can't turn back.
Yeah, she's had sex with the Master Chief. She's caught the feels. Don't she can try to deny all she wants.
Can't cut the Master Cheeks.
Once you go Chief, you can't.
Yeah. That'd be funny. She's like, don't circumcise him. She screamed out like, no, don't circumcise him.
I don't know. He works as a character. I don't think the Covenant should have a girl boss or a female, a human, person in charge. It just
here's an interesting take. Right. You're absolutely right, Forrest. How fucking gosh damn woke is Hollywood that even the Covenant, even an alien species, has to be ran by a girl boss? Is that too woke for everyone in this fucking universe? Because now that you mention it, it's a little woke for me. That's a good point.
Well, they should have just like had the prophets of like truth, mercy, and like regret be the main villains, and like just have them speak in English.
Oh, but like in Halo 2. Master Chief can't have sex with those prophets. Oh, we shouldn't.
Be pretty woke, just like you know.
That would be woke. That would
specious. What are you specious? You won't have sex with a prophet.
No, I
won't. Next.
I won't have sex with the prophet. Truth. I don't want to hear it. It's too mean.
How bad you were in bed.
Yeah, exactly. It's too mean. Yeah, it's too mean.
I won't even tell
technically,
you.
Technically, that's a film.
Yeah, I'll have sex with the prophet of reconciliation, though. Oh, can I try again? Thank you. I appreciate it. I swear I'll make it up to you this time.
Mercy will have sex with you out of pity. The prophet of pity will have sex with you, I guess. That was the episode. I guess hopefully they're not done with the Fall of Reach yet. Hopefully we'll see Master Chief in his armor.
Yeah.
Next episode. And hopefully we see some of the characters from the Halo Reach video game. That'd be fucking awesome.
Would be cool.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm pretty sure they would.
How many episodes till you get his armor back, you think?
A season.
Hopefully next season.
Season 3, yeah. He gets his armor back.
Just keep pissing off the fan base as much as you can, Paramount. Just go for it. Just
you're
like,
oh, are you guys upset already. About seeing his face? Now you're going to see all of him. The whole episode. The whole season.
Maybe if we just take the armor away. Give him a tease the first episode.
They should have just made Master Chief. They just changed the whole lore, make Master Chief ODST. He never had the armor to begin with. Halo game with no armor.
Then they're just gonna like kill all the Covenant, like, and just have the Prometheans be the bad guys for the season. Just piss off the fan base as much as possible. Just go for it.
That's the Marvel strategy. So why wouldn't they try to replicate that as well? That winning strategy.
I think just Hollywood is just do adaptations anymore, or they just, you know,
they're too scared. They're too scared to try something with new.
They just, well, I think the writers are just like, the mentality is just that if they are faithful to the source material, they won't get credit because they want to make it all about them. They want to, like, this is, you know, I'm the one who wrote this. If I just do what someone else wrote, then I won't get any credit.
I remember 10 years ago, boomers were like, millennials suck. And I was like, shut up, you boomer. And now that I'm walking around the real world, and there's a bunch of millennials walking around in the real world doing real world things and doing real world jobs, I'm like, God dang, we suck, dude. We suck so hard. Dude, the customer service sucks. Dude, everything. Everything just sucks. Dude, if I'm trying to get some serious help, if I need some serious help in my real life, and I'm talking to a 35-year-old, dude, I am fucked, dude. Let me talk to your father. I need some actual help here. For the most part, incompetency. Look at what's happening to Hollywood. Like, they're about to destroy the movie industry. And without American culture dominating what's going to happen? We're going to need actual Helldivers to start spreading democracy because Hollywood can't do it.
Did you see the Rogue Elements trailer, the Critical Drinkers? I don't know if it's like a short film, but he's like directing his own movie based on his book. And it's like basically the equivalent of, all right, I'll do it myself.
Nice.
Because he literally, his entire YouTube channel is like him just shitting on movies. Mm-hmm. And he's like, all right, I'll make my own movie. And, you know.
He joins the Daily Wire. They've got their whole new media segment.
Oh, yeah. Gina Carino's like doing all their movies now. Well, she's suing to get her job back at Disney because I guess Daily Wire isn't giving her enough money.
Dude, I mean, so, Disney did her dirty, right? Not only did they fire her, they were like, we're firing her because she's a piece of shit. And she's a terrible human being, and no one should ever work with her again. Like, that was such a disrespectful way to say goodbye, regardless of how you feel about it.
I don't know. I mean, her acting alone was like, should have gotten her fired. But
yeah, that's different, right? Fire her for merit.
Mandalorian at this point. Like, I don't care if she comes back in Mandalorian. I don't care. Well, they can't bring back. Did Carl Weathers film any scenes for season 4? Is he just like?
I haven't heard any news about that. Seen any headlines?
I don't think they've even started filming Mandalorian season 4 or the Mandalorian movie. It's just been announced. Like, they haven't done anything for post season 3 Mandalorian.
Well, good. Don't stop and take a second to think about like what an actual storyline could be for your movie.
And make up your mind if you're going to kill off Moff Gideon or not. Just kill him off, or just kill him off, because I think it's becoming a little like far fetched. This character is still alive after 3 seasons. But yeah, that's our show pretty much. Major, want to plug our social media?
Yeah, absolutely. We were going to do Bad Batch, but we have run out of time. So I guess you should probably just subscribe either on YouTube, Zeitgeist Zealots Reel, or Instagram or TikTok as Zeitgeist Zealots, and then on Twitter, the platform now known as X. You can find us on Z Zealots Podcast. Z Zealots Podcast on X. Everywhere else, it's just Zeitgeist Zealots. You can find us there. We got a ton of shorts on YouTube and Reels and TikTok. So go ahead and check those out. They're pretty awesome. What do you want us to cover next? Do you guys like Halo so far? Because, I mean, it's gotten better, but Force is right. It's nowhere near close to perfect. Really appreciate you guys listening.
Invincible's coming out a week or 2 weeks from now?
March, the first week of March. March 6th or 9th, something okay. like that.
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah. Halo will still be in full swing, but at least we have that to look forward to.
Oh, I guess to be fair to the listeners or whatever, we could cover very quickly episode 1 of Bad Batch from season 3. You can literally cover it up in a single sentence, and I will do so here. Episode 1, recap. Omega is locked up and forced to help her Kaminoan lab mommy look for potential M count suitors for the Emperor. Boom. That's the entire episode. What a fucking waste, Bad Batch. What a terrible episode 1. What a terrible fucking season premiere. You want to fucking lose viewers? That's how you fucking do it, Disney. God, dude, you suck so fucking hard at your job. I cannot believe it. That episode was so fucking boring.
Major, the worst part is, we already know the ending of season 3 of Bad Batch because of The Mandalorian.
Yeah. And because of The Rise of Skywalker. No, so, spoiler, we find out that, just like we said in episode 1, season 1 of The Bad Batch, Omega is the blood clone that Palpatine needs to clone his body for the M count, right? That's exactly right.
Oh,
we figured this out. Yeah, three seasons early or whatever.
I created Snoke.
And so in the end of episode three, Omega gets away. And you're like, oh, will they be able to catch her? Yeah, they're going to fucking catch her. Because guess what? Spoiler alert. Palpatine gets cloned. There's no cliffhanger here. We know it's going to fucking happen. Great writing, Disney.
Palpatine has returned.
Somehow, Palpatine has returned. Somehow. And we will explain it through three awful seasons of Bad Batch.
Somehow, Bad Batch has returned after... I don't know. I thought season two was okay. I mean, I didn't finish it, but...
Oh, well, it wasn't that good then, was it? If you didn't finish it, it's not that good.
No.
Them's the facts.
But yeah, so we got Mensa to look forward to, the boys after that. Fallout is coming out pretty soon. Is that April or March?
You'll have to check a previous episode.
Yeah, so that'll also be on Amazon. So we'll see if Amazon can keep the hot streak going until Rings of Power 2 comes out. But yeah, that's our show.
April 12th. Everyone. Fallout's coming out April 12th.
All right. Okay, ready to...
Yeah, that's our show.
Head out. Yeah, it's our show. I'm Forrest.
I'm Major.
And I'm Robbie.
Matt is back.
All right.